Good morning, children. Already we had learnt the extractive metallurgy of two metals. What are the two metals we had learnt? Aluminium and copper. Extractive metallurgy already we had learnt. Today we are going to learn the extractive metallurgy of another metal, that is iron. Okay, children. So these metals are extracted from their ores. So in connection with that, we are going to learn the various types of ores. Also today we are going to learn the physical and chemical properties of the metal iron. What are alloys? What is an amalgam? And the methods of making alloys. Okay, children. So today's topics are types of ores, extractive metallurgy of iron, physical and chemical properties of iron, alloys, amalgam formation, method of making alloys. Okay, children, let us learn one by one. The first one is types of ores. We have got varieties of ores. Some ores are called as oxide ores, some are carbonate ores, some are halide ores, some are sulfide ores. So like this we can classify the ores on the basis of the elements present in them. Look at the oxide ores, bauxite, cuprite and hematite. They are the examples for oxide ores. The formula for bauxite is Al2O32H2O. Bauxite is the chief ore of the metal aluminium. Cuprite. Cuprite has got the formula copper. Cuprite belongs to the metal copper. Cuprite is an ore of the metal copper. Cuprite, Cu2O. Hematite. Hematite is the ore of iron. Fe2O3. Ferric oxide. Fe2O3. Okay, children. So these are examples for oxide ores, because the chief metal is present in its oxide form. For example, if you take bauxite, here the chief metal, the metal of interest is aluminium. Aluminium is present in its oxide form, aluminium oxide. Similarly, in cuprite, copper is present in its oxide form. Similarly, in hematite also, iron is present in its oxide form. So these ores, bauxite, cuprite and hematite, they are called as oxide ores, because the element which is going to be extracted from these ores is present in its oxide form. So these ores are called as oxide ores. Okay, children. Coming to the next type, it is carbonate ores. Examples are marble, magnesite, siderite. Marble, magnesite, siderite. Marble has got the molecular formula CaCO3. It is nothing but calcium carbonate. So calcium carbonate is marble. Magnesite, magnesium. Magnesium carbonate is magnesite. Siderite, iron carbonate. Siderite, iron carbonate is the ore of iron, the metal iron. Okay. So here when we analyze the carbonate ores, the metals which are going to be extracted from these ores are present in their carbonate forms. Calcium carbonate. Calcium is the metal which can be extracted from calcium carbonate. So calcium is present in its carbonate form, so it comes under the category carbonate ore. Similarly, magnesite, magnesium carbonate. Here the metal is magnesium. It is present in its carbonate form. Similarly, iron metal, siderite, FeCO3, iron carbonate. Okay, children. Coming to the next type, halide ores. These ores contain one or more halogens in them. That's why they are categorized under halide ores. Cryolite. Cryolite. One of the ores of aluminium. Cryolite. Na3AlF6. Na3AlF6 is cryolite. Fluorspar. Calcium fluoride. Ore of calcium. Calcium fluoride. CaF2. Rock salt. Sodium chloride, common salt, that is sodium chloride, NaCl, So these are some examples for halide ores: cryolite, fluorspar, rock salt. Cryolite has got the formula Na3AlF6. Fluorspar has got the formula CaF2. Rock salt has got the formula NaCl. Okay, children? You are familiar with rock salt. Coming to sulfide ores, sulfide. So, sulfur is present in these ores, and so these ores are categorized as sulfide ores. Galena. Galena is the sulfide ore of lead. Pb. Pb for plumbum, the Latin name of lead. Plumbum. So, Pb, yes. Lead sulfide is galena. Iron pyrite. Similar to iron pyrite, we are also having copper pyrite, CuFeS2, that is copper pyrite, that is also a sulfide ore. Here iron pyrite, FeS2, iron sulfide, that is iron pyrite. Then zinc blend, wherever we get blend, it is nothing but a sulfide ore. Zinc blend, ZnS, yes, zinc sulfide. Okay, children? So sulfide ores examples are galena, iron pyrite, zinc blend. Galena has got the formula PbS. Iron pyrite has got the formula FeS2. Zinc blend has got the formula ZnS. Okay, children. So these are various types of ores which you have to memorize. These formulas, the names of these ores and also their formulas, you should be thorough, children. This is the basis for inorganic chemistry. Okay, extraction of metals, extractive metallurgy of various metals. Without metals, we cannot have this happy life. So, metals play a vital role in our daily life, and you learn to try to learn this tabla column today itself. Okay, children, shall we move to the next topic? Yes, it is extractive metallurgy of iron. Extractive metallurgy of iron. It means we are going to separate the metal iron from its ore. Many ores of iron are there. They are hematite, magnetite, iron pyrite. These are the very important ores of iron. Hematite, magnetite, iron pyrite. Hematite has got the formula Fe2O3, ferric oxide. Ferric oxide, Fe2O3. Magnetite has got the formula Fe3O4. Iron pyrite, FeS2. Among these ores of iron, hematite is the chief ore of iron from which the extractive metallurgy of iron is done. Because when we do the extractive metallurgy of iron from the ore, hematite, maximum amount of iron can be extracted profitably and economically. And so, the chief ore of iron is hematite, having the formula Fe2O3. Since it is an oxide ore, it is separated by gravity separation process. So, the steps involved in the extractive metallurgy of iron are concentration by gravity separation process, roasting and calcination, smelting in a blast furnace. So, like this, we have got three main steps involved in the extractive metallurgy of iron. What are the three steps involved in the extractive metallurgy of iron? They are concentration by gravity separation process, roasting and calcination, smelting in a blast furnace. When we do smelting in a blast furnace, we are having three zones in the blast furnace. They are the lower region is called as combustion zone, because here combustion takes place, oxidation takes place. Then we are having middle zone, fusion takes place, it is a fusion zone. Then the third one is the upper region called reduction zone, here reduction takes place. So these are the three main steps involved in the extractive metallurgy of the metal iron. First one is concentration by gravity separation process. The ore, the main ore of the chief ore of iron is hematite. It is taken powdered well. It is allowed to be, it is kept, it is allowed to be placed on a sloping table. Water of high speed is allowed to flow over this powdered ore which is placed on the sloping table. The lighter impurities which have low specific gravity are washed away by the force of running water, whereas the metal which has got the metal or the ore, here ore, the impurities are washed away by the force of running water, and the ore which is having high specific gravity is retained in the wedges of the sloping table. Okay, children, so this process is called as gravity separation process. This process is mainly used for concentrating means we are removing the impurities present in the ore, because when we mine the ore from the earth crust, it has got some impurities. So first the ore that's taken from the earth crust is washed, powdered well, then it is concentrated according to the type of ore. Here the type of ore is oxide ore. So we are concentrating it by gravity separation process. Okay, children, so this is gravity separation process, the very first step in the extractive metallurgy of iron. The next step is roasting and calcination. Okay, see, when we roast, the impurities present, arsenic, sulfur, and the impurities present in the ore, they are removed as their oxides. And then calcination is done. What is calcination? Heating the ore in the absence of air. That is called as calcination. Okay, children, roasting is heating the ore in the presence of oxygen. That is in the presence of excess of oxygen. Calcination is heating the ore in the absence or with less amount of air. That is called as calcination. So when we do roasting and calcination, the impurities, the unwanted substances present in the ore are removed. They are removed. So that is the second step involved in the extractive metallurgy of iron. The third step is smelting. What is smelting? Smelting is a reduction process in which the metallic oxide is reduced to its metal. So this smelting is usually carried out in a blast furnace. Okay, let us learn smelting in detail. See, this is a smelting. This furnace is blast furnace. Okay, children, it has got different zones. The lower zone, middle zone, and the upper zone. Combustion zone, fusion zone, and the reduction zone. Okay, yes. Now let us move to the next slide. Here we are taking charge. What do you mean by charge? Charge is a mixture of roasted ore, coke, and limestone in the ratio 8:4:1. Okay, the roasted ore's ratio is 8, coke is nothing but charcoal, children. Charcoal, carbon. See, when people iron the clothes, no, they use a black color charcoal. That is coke. It is a very good reducing agent. Then limestone, calcium carbonate. That is limestone. Okay. So, in the smelting process, which is involved in the extractive metallurgy of the metal iron, a mixture is taken, charge. That mixture is called as charge. Charge is a mixture of iron ore, roasted iron ore, then coke, that is carbon, and limestone. And the ratio of roasted ore, coke, and limestone is 8:4:1. 8:4:1. So, the amount of roasted ore is large. then coke, then calcium carbonate, limestone. Okay, children? So this is charges allowed to flow into the furnace. Then we are having different zones. These zones are classified on the basis of the temperature maintained in this region. The lower zone consists of the highest temperature, that is 1500 degree Celsius. 1500 degree Celsius, children. It is a combustion zone. Here, carbon, that is nothing but the coke, which is present in the charge, gets oxidized to carbon dioxide with the release of large amount of heat. So, a chemical reaction in which heat is released is called as exothermic reaction. So, this is an exothermic reaction because when carbon and oxygen combine together to produce carbon dioxide, heat is released. So, it is an exothermic reaction. The temperature maintained here is 1500 degrees Celsius. The next zone is the middle zone. It is also called as the fusion zone. The temperature maintained here is 1000 degrees Celsius. Here, reduction takes place. Carbon dioxide is reduced to carbon monoxide. CO2 is reduced to carbon monoxide, CO. It is called as reduction because one of the oxygen atoms present in carbon dioxide is removed. We are removing oxygen. We are reducing the number of oxygen atoms present in a compound. So, this process is called as reduction. Okay, children? On the contrary, if we add one or more oxygen atoms to a compound and increase the number of oxygen atoms present in a compound, then that process is called as oxidation. The antonym of reduction is oxidation. Okay? Then come to the equations in middle zone, that is the reactions that take place in middle zone. Carbon dioxide, which was formed in the lower region, combines again with carbon. Carbon is nothing but coke to produce carbon monoxide. So this carbon is a very good reducing agent. It reduces carbon dioxide to carbon monoxide with the absorption of heat. See, minus heat means heat is absorbed in this reaction, so it is an endothermic reaction. A chemical reaction in which heat is absorbed in is called as endothermic reaction. Similarly, limestone which is also present in charge is reduced as calcium oxide, lime, calcium oxide plus CO2. Carbon dioxide with the absorption of heat, and so this reaction is an endothermic reaction. So in middle zone, carbon dioxide is reduced to carbon, calcium carbonate is reduced to calcium oxide, is converted to calcium oxide and carbon dioxide. These two reactions are endothermic reactions because heat is absorbed by these reactions. Then calcium oxide, formed by the decomposition of calcium carbonate, reacts with silica, SiO2, to form the slag, calcium silicate. Calcium silicate, CaSiO3. This is calcium silicate and it is the slag. This is not needed for us, so it is removed. Then, coming to the reduction zone or the upper region, the temperature maintained here is 400 degrees Celsius. What happens? Hematite ore, Fe2O3, reacts with the carbon monoxide produced in the middle zone to form Fe, iron plus carbon dioxide. Children, similar to coke, carbon monoxide is also a very good reducing agent. I told you, when the number of oxygen atoms in a compound is decreased, it is called as reduction. And when the number of oxygen atoms in a compound is increased, it is called as oxidation, I told. Also, when the oxidation number or the oxidation state of a metal is increased, it is said to be oxidized. If the oxidation number of a metal is decreased, then it is said to be reduced. Okay. See, when you look at this example, you will follow, children. This in the reduction zone, look at the last equation, Fe2O3, ferric oxide, hematite. When it reacts with three molecules, three moles of carbon monoxide, it forms Fe, the metal ion, and carbon dioxide. Here, look into the left hand side, Fe2O3. So what is the oxidation number of iron here? Plus 3. What is the valency of iron in Fe2O3, children? Plus 3. Valency is 3 and the oxidation number is plus 3. This plus indicates that the metals are electropositive. Valency and the oxidation states of the elements are same. When we represent a valency, we don't usually include the signs plus or minus. But when we tell about the oxidation state of elements, we use plus 3, minus 3. This plus and minus indicate that plus indicates that it is a metal and minus indicates that it is a non-metal. Okay, children. So Fe2O3. Here the oxidation number of the metal ion is plus 3. Coming to the right hand side, iron is present in the elementary state. It is present alone. So its oxidation number is 0. So you have to compare the oxidation state of iron when it is present as a reactant and when it is present as a product. When it is present as a reactant, its oxidation number is plus 3. When it is present as a product, its oxidation number is 0. So the oxidation number of the metal ion is reduced from plus 3 to 0. So this is a reduction process and this reduction takes place in reduction zone. So children, we have got iron. The metal ion is extracted from its ore, hematite. Okay. Now, coming to the physical properties, coming to the physical properties of iron, here iron is lustrous. It is shiny in nature. It is grayish white in color. It has got high tensile strength. It can withstand very high temperature. It can withstand very high pressure. It can withstand very high tension. So it has got high tensile strength. It is malleable and ductile. It can be beaten into sheets and made into wires. And electromagnets are there. In our school we are having lift. It works under electromagnet. So very big electromagnets are made with the metal iron. Okay, children. So iron can be magnetized. So these are some of the physical properties of the metal iron. Okay. So lustrous, metal iron is lustrous, grayish white in color. It is having high tensile strength. It is malleable and ductile. It can be magnetized. Malleable means the metal can be beaten. When it is beaten with a hammer, it can be made into sheets. That property of metals is called as malleability. And the property of making the metal into thin wires is called as ductility. Iron wires we are having, so iron is ductile in nature. Coming to the chemical properties of iron, when iron reacts with air, it forms Fe3O4. It is black in color. When iron reacts with moist air in presence of water, it produces rust. See, when you leave your cycle in rain for 1 or 2 days and if you leave it without caring, that is without wiping the rainwater, if you allow it to be like that itself, if you don't care about your cycle, what happens to the forks of the wheels present in the cycle? They develop rust. Rust particles come, they develop. Rusting takes place in the forks of the wheels of the cycle. So for rusting, the two important factors that are needed are oxygen, that is air, oxygen and water, moisture. okay children. So when iron reacts with air, moist air, it produces rust, Fe2O3 X molecules of water. This is the formula for rust, Fe2O3 X molecules of water. Then coming to the next one, when iron reacts with steam, water steam, it produces Fe3O4 with the liberation of hydrogen gas. When iron reacts with chlorine, it produces ferric chloride, FeCl3 means ferric. Coming to the next one, with dilute hydrochloric acid, iron forms ferrous chloride. This is the difference, children. It forms ferrous chloride, FeCl2. Cl2 means ferrous. When iron reacts with dilute sulfuric acid, it forms ferrous sulfate and hydrogen. Whenever a metal reacts with an acid, it produces salt, the corresponding salt and hydrogen gases released. Okay, children. Then coming to the next chemical properties of iron, when iron reacts with concentrated nitric acid, it produces ferrous nitrate, FeNO3 twice, ferrous nitrate plus ammonium nitrate and water molecules. When iron reacts with concentrated sulfuric acid, it produces ferric sulfate, FeSO4 thrice. Ferric sulfate, sulfur dioxide and water molecules. So these are some of the chemical properties of the metal iron. Coming to the uses of iron, we have got varieties of iron based on the percentage of carbon present in them. Pig iron, it has got the highest percentage of carbon. Steel, it is having lesser than 0.25% of carbon. Whereas the wrought iron, it has got maximum 2% of carbon, 0.25 to 2% of carbon is present in it. So based on the percentage of carbon, iron is of different types: pig iron, steel iron, then wrought iron. Pig iron is mainly used in the making of manhole and pipes. Steel is made use in the making of construction of buildings, bridges, towers, TV towers, telephone towers. They are all made with the help of steel. Wrought iron, it is mainly used in making electromagnets. Okay, children. Pig iron, it is used in the making of pipes. Steel, it is used in the construction of bridges, buildings. Wrought iron, in the making of electromagnets. So these are the uses of iron, some of the uses of iron. Okay, coming to the next topic, alloys. What are alloys? Alloys are nothing but combination of a metal with another metal or a metal with a non-metal leads to the formation of alloys. What is the need for making an alloy? See, we are having when silver is mixed with the other elements, it forms its alloys. Copper, when it is mixed with the other elements like zinc, it forms its own alloys. Similarly, zinc, when it is mixed with the copper, it is called as brass. So what is an alloy? An alloy is a mixture of metals or a metal with a non-metal. That is an alloy. When the metal is converted into its alloy form, the life of that metal is increased. The tensile strength of that metal is increased. The value of that metal is increased. And so there is a need for alloy formation. How to form these alloys? These alloys are formed by fusing the metals together or by compressing finely divided metals. Example for fusing the metals together is brass. Zinc and copper combination is called as brass. Compressing finely divided metals, example is wood metal. That is, it is an alloy of metals like tin, lead, bismuth, cadmium. CD for cadmium, children. Lead, tin, bismuth and cadmium. They combine to form the wood metal. Okay, we can also call this alloy as a solid solution in which the metal is present in large concentration. So the metal acts as the solvent and the other metals. The main metal, the chief metal acts as the solvent, whereas the other metals, they act as solutes. What is a solution, children? It is a combination of solute and solvent. For example, if we take sodium chloride solution, here water is the solvent and sodium chloride is the solute. So the substance which is present in larger amount in a solution is called as a solvent. The substance which is present in a smaller amount in a solution is called as a solute. Here, when we consider alloys as solid solutions, the metals are present in larger amount and the concentration of the metals is large. So they are considered to be solvents. When we compare the concentrations of the other metals, it is low, so they are considered to be solutes. Okay, children. So today we have learnt the types of ores, the extractive metallurgy of the metal, iron, physical and chemical properties of iron, and also alloys. When we talk about alloys, we should know what is amalgam. Amalgam means whenever a metal is mixed with mercury, it is called as amalgam. A metal plus mercury is called as amalgam. Silver amalgam. When silver metal is mixed with the metal mercury, it is called as silver amalgam. Tin amalgam. Zinc amalgam. Okay. So amalgam stands for, amalgam is an alloy. We can say amalgam is an alloy formed by mixing mercury with other metals. Mercury with metals. Silver amalgam, copper amalgam, zinc amalgam, tin amalgam. So tin amalgam means the metal tin is mixed with mercury. Okay, children. I hope you might have understood today's class. Thank you, children.